All right, it's time for Savannah Lexicon. How is everybody today? This is Wayne Waters, your host to Savannah Lexicon. And just to make sure you understand, you are listening to WRUULP, Savannah, Georgia, 107.5 FM, WRUU.org. We are Savannah Soundings, community radio with global soul. Okay, and I do appreciate so much you listening to Savannah Lexicon today. Savannah Lexicon every Tuesday and Thursday, 8 till 9 in the morning. And if you're a first-time listener, I will just tell you that Savannah Lexicon is a show designed to inform the listener about important social, political, and cultural issues that shape Savannah, as well as about opportunities to experience things in and around this beautiful city that might bring an added measure of grace and joy to your life. And this show is of and about Savannah and surrounding communities, but it is a very community-based, community-focused kind of show. All right, first off... As regular listeners know, I have to give you a very important word up front before we even get started. It's exciting. It's just such a thing. It is the general disclaimer. So hold on to your hats, ladies and gentlemen. The viewpoints expressed in the following program are not necessarily those of WRUU, its license holder, or its staff. That was breathtaking, wasn't it? Okay. Today's guest for Savannah Lexicon is Cindy Murphy Kelley, Executive Director, Chatham Savannah Authority for the Homeless. How are you, Cindy?
I'm good. Good morning.
I am so happy to have you in the studio today, and we'll talk about this... This difficult, devilish issue of, the homeless scenario. There are a number of homeless, as anyone who lives here knows, there are a number of homeless in and around the city. And, I doubt very seriously they're homeless by choice. So it's an unfortunate situation. In fact, the numbers that I've had that was in the newspaper recently for 2016, a total of 4,513 homeless people in and around the city. Unfortunately, 805 of them are children, which is a real shame. Now, that number is going up. We had a little bit of a dip, but honestly, the numbers since 2012 are essentially unchanged. They're in the same close range. And unfortunately, though, the number of children has gone up in that time period as well. So more children out there than have been. Of course, these numbers are very, very approximate. I mean, it's a difficult...
Actually, they're fairly accurate. I welcome the opportunity to share how we derive that number. That's an annual count. Mm-hmm. So it's one homeless person receiving one service in 2016. So it's an unduplicated count. So that number may not include everyone who's homeless for the whole year. But it is the number of folks that are certified as homeless who've used one service. We have a fairly sophisticated HMIS system that tracks our numbers, and that is how we get to that number.
Okay. But I would be willing to bet there are homeless out there who've never used your services.
There are. There are more than that. It does not include about 800 children who go to our public school system in Chatham County, because the HUD definition of those individuals, those children, is different than the one that we use in our annual count. So another way to think about this is to add about 800 students in our public schools who are living in weekly hotels or who are couch surfing or who are on the street.
Okay. So, yeah, I think the numbers are pretty approximate. But at any rate, we have as good a grip on them as we can. And and know the pretty precise numbers of those who are in fact using your services, which is certainly helpful. Okay, well, wow. Where to start? I'll just read off of your webpage, if I may. The Chatham Savannah Authority for the Homeless nonprofit organization, and according to what I saw on the webpage, committed to strategic approaches to addressing the challenges of homelessness to lead the effort to build and sustain community practices to eliminate homelessness. The organization provides street outreach, which you can tell us about here in just a minute. You kind of mentioned already, and case management services for individuals and families. So walk-in hours are Monday through Friday, 8 to 5. Is that right? And the address, 761 Wheaton Street, the third floor of the DFCS building.
The DFACS building.
The DFACS building.
Correct.
Yes. Okay. There you go. All right. Well, just that explains your mission pretty well. But just tell us, if you will, a little bit more about the organization and you know and what you do and what you offer to the community.
Sure. We were founded in 1989 by the Georgia Legislature to provide as a convening organization and a coordinator of homeless services in all of Chatham County. And I think that over time we have realized, especially in the last 3.5 years, that we need to focus more specifically on affordable housing than on homelessness. And frankly, as a community, we have not been successful in reducing the number of homeless folks in our community.
Yeah,
and that is a result of inadequate policy and planning countywide on affordable housing. We have a nonprofit provider community here that does direct service well, but doesn't adequately work together to plan for strategic decisions that impact the long-range health of our community related to housing. Our nonprofit sector struggles, and coming from another community where the nonprofit sector was very strong, I see the significant differences with respect to success on this issue. And I think we're moving away from talking about homelessness and really focusing on affordable housing needs in our community.
Okay. Well, seems reasonable to me. I mean, homelessness is about not having a home.
That so, is what
you
it
know,
is about.
It's about
yes.
housing. You
Correct.
Know, intrinsically, it's about housing. An incredible structure, it seems to me, now a total layman in regards to any of these things, but Savannah to me, because I've lived in various places myself and you're just aware of kinds of programs and operations and whatnot, I mean, Savannah to me seems to have extraordinarily strong and numerous organizations dedicated to poverty and job opportunities and all of these sorts of things, an incredible infrastructure about that, an incredible number of nonprofit organizations in and out of the government structure itself that are dedicated to these kinds of things, but maybe not so much as you're suggesting, that's just really straight on dealing with the idea of providing living arrangements. And
yes, I think I think we're stuck a little bit in a time warp here with respect to thinking about how we serve. I know that many of us feel good if we serve meals at a homeless shelter or we provide a handout, but it doesn't really solve the underlying problem.
Yeah.
And I know that the nonprofits in our continuum of care are struggling with the move away from housing readiness, which basically says to an individual, you do this, this, and that, and if you perform well for us, then we may find you housing.
Right.
Versus
right.
a much more direct approach that is really cheaper in the long run. We will get you housing. You will stabilize. We will work with you on your trauma issues, and then you'll have an opportunity to meet your goals. And it's a pretty significant shift for the community. Even when I speak to public groups, you know, one of the first things I hear is, you know, when's he going to get a job, or, you know, can he work? And, you know, the question is, it depends. Our veteran numbers are up substantially over last year. These are folks who have served our country that have a variety of challenges, and many of them are living in the woods.
Yeah.
We could do better.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. All right. Let's set the stage a little bit here. I think I would be remiss if I didn't talk about the several sorts of comments and editorials that have appeared in the newspaper here recently, one from you, one from the editorial board of the Savannah Morning News, and then one from the city manager. So you had an article in there recently. I don't remember the exact date, but it's been, well, I do have it. It's July 22nd was when this appeared in the newspaper. And you talked about really saying what you're saying right now, but going into some further detail, that we have simply not been successful in reducing homelessness.
Yes.
And that clearly we need to do some things differently. So I'm actually quoting you a bit here out of this. You also noted, as you have now, that the key factor is lack of affordable and available housing. You mentioned in there, and this was... this was paraphrased, really. It wasn't a direct quote from you, but the continuing inability of the city of Savannah and Chatham County officials to get together and make progress on this. And then further, that you had indicated $0 coming from the city of Savannah to support housing.
And actually, that should be corrected. It was $0 to come from the city of Savannah and the county of Chatham for the tiny house capital project.
Oh, so you were talking about specifically the tiny house.
I was, yes.
Okay, and that's an interesting project, and you went into this in the article, the tiny house project, 72 small houses for some of Savannah's homeless veterans, particularly.
Correct.
Who are now homeless in camps around the city. Rent for about $210 a month, and again, correct me if anything I'm giving is wrong.
That is correct.
But you had started an initiative in this regard, particularly for that population, and I remember it actually, there was a tiny house at the Earth Day Festival, I think.
Ah.
Right?
Maybe.
Yes.
I didn't see it.
Well,
yes.
I think there was.
Okay.
And... so, you know, and that was, it's pretty nice. I mean, this would be, it's just, they're very small, but, you know, they're good shelter.
And actually, they're built just like a regular house. They're just small. They're fully insulated. They meet code.
Mm-hmm.
They're very efficient. One way to think about it is like a single room occupancy. We call them SROs, which are basically rooms in a larger building. These are like SROs, but they are their own unit where you can actually walk in and out and lock your door.
There you go. Okay. Well, and apparently Savannah has not responded very well to that initiative, it seems. We've not necessarily, you've not been able to garner much in the way of...
Well, I would say the broader public has been wonderful. We continue to raise money from individuals in our community and corporations. We've had a lot of help there. You know, we would like to see Chatham County step up and take a larger role. And ultimately, if our organization moves away from the lead agency responsibility for the continuum of care and moves into housing development, and our board has been talking about it, ultimately it is Chatham County's responsibility to take on the leadership role for homeless services in our community. And that, that would definitely be a shift. The city of Savannah has been a partner in a variety of areas with respect to serving the homeless and on housing, but much of that money comes from the feds, and we have to adjust based on who's in power on the federal level.
Sure.
And frankly, without a comprehensive Chatham County-led plan to address affordable housing, I'm not sure we're going to make the success that we really need. The Housing Authority of Savannah keeps a waiting list of those who want affordable housing and who qualify, and that list is 15,000 people.
Yeah, I saw that. That's, I mean, my God, 15,000 people.
That gives you a sense of why we have such a significant homeless population. We have people who are paying more than they can afford for housing. They live on the edge of eviction. And I think that one of the things that we are not seeing that at some point probably is going to be revealed is that we have a very high eviction rate here. Mm. And what that means is, if people are moving in and out due to eviction, it appears that there's housing available
right,
as people move
right.
into it. But if they don't keep it, they end up in our homeless shelters or on the street.
Right. Okay. All right. And just continued a little bit with this back and forth in the newspaper. The Savannah Morning News editorial started out their editorial with quote, "If city and county leaders are seriously interested in reducing homelessness in the community, then they should pay attention to what Cindy Murphy Kelley has been saying about this complex problem." So the editorial board there at the Morning News agrees, you know, with your perspective in general about this. Then Rob Hernandez, our city manager, of course, posted on the 27th, posted a column about this and kind of taking a different view, shall we say, regarding your quote that $0 come from the city to support housing. But as you said, you were talking about the specific program of tiny houses. At any rate, he lays out in this editorial that he did about the various monies that come from the city and all of that in various programs. Many of the programs and the dollars he was referring to were not really necessarily quite literally, specifically, directly involved with a housing.
Correct.
You know.
The programs that the city have to do with rehab of housing that
right.
really needs that.
Yep.
There is a program that supports home ownership for low-income folks.
Right.
Another program looks at, you know, vacant and boarded up homes and empty lots in neighborhoods.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that they have a specific focus, and I think it's appropriate for the citizens of Savannah.
Yep.
But it's not part of a comprehensive approach that builds affordable housing in every neighborhood.
Right.
And, you know, that's something that we are clear is a strategy that we need to look at. And frankly, the city and the county are going to have to work together on this issue. And we know that that's a challenge.
Yes.
And so I think that without that cooperation, we have been clear that we are not successful. We've recently had a national expert on homelessness and housing named Philip Mangano coming to our community. He's been here 3 times. He's done public speaking. And in a meeting that I had with him, where he was summarizing what he's seen in our community, he reminded me that our nonprofit organization's job is not to solve this issue.
Mm.
Our job is to pull people together to solve this issue.
Mm.
Because as one nonprofit organization, we simply don't have the power to impact public policy in a way that will really support the development of affordable housing, which is the primary reason as an organization we are shifting and looking seriously at becoming a nonprofit housing developer. We really are short of those kinds of nonprofits in our community. It's complicated. It's expensive. It takes a long time. It's definitely a specialty.
Yeah.
But if we don't start doing it and make an impact little bit by little bit, we will just be having this conversation in 5 years, and I'll be gone. Sitting on the beach at Tybee.
Well, let me back up just a minute. I mean, I kind of have to say, I sort of, when you say that you can't affect public policy, I don't know that I would agree with that. You can't directly necessarily do
as a lone
things,
agency.
But we need
to do it as a collaborative.
Yeah. Well,
yes.
Sure. Okay. But I mean, I'm sure that the city and county government certainly at least are aware of what you do and what you say and your recommendations, your ideas about these things. Surely they at least
listen
to those and at least, you know, use them as they try and determine what they need to do. But as a direct thing, you're saying yes, for sure.
Yes, the collaborative is really important. So I'll give you a couple examples of public policy that we've been talking about for some time, and that's regarding new housing developments.
Mm-hmm.
There are two ways that many other communities across the country address creating a fund for affordable housing. One is to have developers pay into a fund each time they do a project. Another is to set aside X number of units in each new housing development of 10 units or more.
Mm-hmm.
That ensures that there is some affordable housing in every new development. But what we have here, and frankly, it makes me sad when I see all the beautiful new developments and I know that they are not affordable to the people who need housing most.
Yeah.
I look at the beautiful units along President Street that have recently been completed. I look at the one that the Victorian neighborhood is fussing about.
Yeah.
There's no discussion about how can we make some units available for people who need those affordable housing units so desperately. If we came together and all developers had to do it, then no one would feel they were singled out. And I think it's appropriate. I think the healthiest communities have affordable housing in every neighborhood.
Okay. All right, boy. It's a tough thing, though. It does get complicated, and it does deal with various city and or county agencies. It deals with zoning issues. It deals with all of these issues. So it does get to be very, very complicated very quickly. And what you're seem to be suggesting is your department, is it?
We actually are a 501c3 nonprofit.
Yeah, you're a nonprofit. Mm-hmm. You're the nonprofit that you're the executive director of is interested in being, to put it in a very general manner, not really precise manner, but general manner, that you want to be more involved in direct, what, direct
A couple of areas, the development of affordable housing
and
the influencing of appropriate public policy to ensure that we are moving along this path. And frankly, it's going to be more than 20 years. If we had good policy and we got moving on it now, the need is so significant.
Wow.
But it hurts our community that we continue to build when the economy is booming and not paying attention to the inevitable slow growth of the economy when poverty goes up.
Yeah.
When I see all the hotels being built downtown, I cringe a little bit because I know that we're going to overbuild, or we are overbuilding, and we'll notice that when the economy slows down. And I think, you know, the same is true for, you know, looking at housing. We should use the opportunities when things are a bit better to invest in the housing that's so desperately needed.
Okay. And in terms of location of housing of this sort, I mean, is there a preference from your perspective? Should it be just spread out throughout the entire city or some particular area designated for it, or?
It should be spread out throughout the entire county, and there should be affordable housing sprinkled into every new development. It is a best practice. Folks in the community don't notice who's low income. It allows those folks who would never have the opportunity to live in areas to be given that opportunity. And I think it's important that we realize that concentrated low-income housing has been left behind by most communities. We still have some of it, and I know over time that that will change, and I know some of the new development that is happening with the Housing Authority is mixed-income housing, which is appropriate. But this idea that we're going to build lots of housing in one area and put a lot of poor people in it has been long considered a problem. And so we really have to think about how we can incorporate housing that's affordable everywhere.
Now, let's be honest about this issue, because we all know that there are going to be folks in various neighborhoods who don't want it.
There will be.
And
what I would say is that we need to challenge our leaders to step up and say, too bad. This is something that our community needs, and we need to incorporate it in a way that's thoughtful. And it's not that we don't listen to the concerns of the neighborhood. But as I said, we're not talking about, you know, putting 150 units in an area filled with folks who are low income and struggling. We're talking about incorporating design and community development that considers the needs of all of the individuals in our community, no matter what their income.
Okay. All right. We are just about at the halfway point here of the show, so we are going to take a brief pause for the cause, but don't go anywhere, because we are going to be back very soon and move into the second half. So everybody just hang on. I do want to let you know that we're coming up. We've got another half an hour for the show, so don't go anywhere. We're not going anywhere. Hang on. Okie doke, we are back. We are back indeed, and I'm happy you're still listening to Savannah Lexicon. We've still got almost a half hour to go. I am talking with Cindy Murphy Kelley, Executive Director of Chatham Savannah Authority for the Homeless, an important issue and an important service here in Savannah, Georgia, of course. I did want to make note of a few things I saw reported lately, and Cindy, you may have some comment about this too. The city recently ended a grant agreement through Emergency Solutions Grants with the Salvation Army. They ended that arrangement. And new grants are going to Family Promises and City Night Shelter. The city did get a bump in homeless assistance funds, nearly $700,000 in extra funds to go towards shelter, outreach, and employment. And I noted in the newspaper recently a little editorial from the Savannah Morning News editorial page editor Tom Barton about Park Place Outreach, which is essentially a kind of a safe house kind of scenario, if I understand it. With just 12 beds, but it's a 12-bed shelter serving boys and girls between the ages of 11 and 17 who are in some sort of distress and need a temporary safe place. So that's Park Place Outreach. But again, the funding through the city for homeless has made a change here. What might you say about the change in funding and the change in organizations there?
Well, the agencies that you mentioned, Inner City Night Shelter, Park Place Outreach, and Salvation Army, these agencies are all key members of our continuum of care.
Mm-hmm.
And the dollars that you mentioned are HUD dollars, Housing and Urban Development dollars, that go to the City of Savannah. And then the City of Savannah subcontracts to the agencies, the nonprofit agencies in our continuum of care through a competitive process to help with some of these issues. I think, you know, one of the challenges that we have is that sometimes because of our housing problem here, it makes it difficult to spend the dollars. Mm. And so the primary reason that the city often reopens the process and reallocates the funds is that the agency is, for whatever the reason, unable to spend the dollars. And that can be for many reasons. One reason can be that HUD has made new regulations and the agency can't perform with the new regulations. There is a lot of red tape with federal dollars.
I'm sure. Yeah.
And the challenge, though, that we have is that HUD expects our community to spend those dollars. And when we don't spend those dollars, it affects the score of our master HUD grant that we submit as an agency each year.
Mm.
Our HUD score for the Chatham area community has been poor, and it's primarily related to lack of housing options. So the most clear example is that HUD expects when a person goes into emergency shelter that they will leave in 30 days and they will exit into housing. And we don't have housing for them.
Right.
So some of the dollars are used for what's called rapid rehousing. It's a great idea, and it works in communities that have housing.
Right.
And basically, it is that we rapid rehouse folks after that 30 days into housing. But if we don't have housing to rapid rehouse them to, we're not able to use the dollars.
Mm, right. Now, let me just throw this out here while I'm thinking about it. You know what? Before I do that, let's do what I meant to do when we came back from the break and did not do, and then we'll get back to the issue. But just briefly, just tell us a little bit about yourself. Just give us a kind of a nutshell. As I understand it, you've had a lot of experience with all of this sort of thing. So you're from where now?
I grew up in La Crosse, Wisconsin, and spent 30 years in Minneapolis. I've been leading nonprofit organizations as executive director since 1996. With one exception, when I led an international organization, I've always worked with individuals and families in poverty and facing a variety of challenges, including an outpatient mental health and substance abuse clinic, an elementary school, a transitional school that served homeless children and their families, and then most recently, of course, with the Chatham Savannah Authority for the Homeless. So my perspective, I do have an MBA, so I do think about the economics of these issues, and I think that I combine both an economic view with a social services approach and best practices. I've also taught on the graduate level in nonprofit leadership and management for a decade, and that has brought me a perspective about how nonprofits that are highly functional and collaborative can really influence public policy, and how here in Savannah, Chatham, where the nonprofit sector is quite weak, that their impact is lost. And, you know, part of my challenge when I look at the community is I look at the United Way's opportunity to provide that leadership, and I don't feel like we're seeing that in a way that really makes a difference. I'm used to working with a United Way agency that wants to influence public policy, that demands best practice from agencies, has no concerns about defunding agencies that don't have adequate outcomes, but we could grow there, both in influence and impact.
Okay. Several things there. First off, you sound like the right woman for the job. You've had some great experience, so a heck of a resume there. So that's encouraging. First off, I will say that I suspect we may have another letter to the editor or editorial in the newspaper coming, but that's fine too. The conversation needs to be had one way or another. A couple of things I wanted to ask is just on a more personal note, what is it that has encouraged you and made you get into this sort of social service kinds of work going way back in the first place? What would you?
Well, you know, I grew up in a low-income family, large Irish, Polish, Catholic family. However, there were always adults around who cared, I had that safety net. And, you know, in my community, we had Native American children who really struggled. And as a child, even though we didn't have a lot, I certainly saw other children who had much less.
Right.
And I was just always interested in this idea that who you are born to makes all the difference. And this idea that we are all born equal is just not true. We are born with advantages and disadvantages.
Yep.
And so I've always been interested in doing work that makes a difference. And after college, I had a small child care program, was very interested in kids, and then moved into nonprofit after that, and had the opportunity to see the difference for kids who lived in high poverty situations as opposed to middle class kids.
Right.
And the difference in their performance at kindergarten and third grade. And now I'm just working with folks on the other end. Many of our homeless folks didn't get what they needed when they were young.
Right.
And as a society, we just don't want to think about that because it's such a long-term view.
Yeah.
But it really makes a difference. All this violence that we're seeing in our community,
yeah,
we're creating that by not giving folks what they need in the early years. And this idea that Americans have that it's all about personal responsibility It's just silly. Yes, I expected when my teenagers were at home that they had personal responsibility, but they also grew up with plenty and with what they needed. And kids who don't get that and are looking for that acceptance end up in gangs and in lots of trouble. And then they end up in prison, and then they end up in my homeless camps. So the cycle is very clear.
Okay. All right. Well, that's so good. I'm nice, glad to hear that. And it's wonderful to have folks like you who are committed to this sort of thing. It's not you know, the most lucrative avenue one can take in terms of jobs
that would be
scenarios.
True.
So, you know, I mean, we should appreciate anybody who's involved in a nonprofit that is aimed at trying to help things in a general sense and in various various needs a community may have. So I appreciate it, and I'm sure a lot of people out there do. Now, one thing you said, too, though, that sticks in my mind is the comment that the nonprofit sector is so weak here. Now, and I'm going to ask you to sort of explain that a little bit because, again, and I'm a total novice in all of this. I'm not a professional in this endeavor in terms of nonprofits and the funding. It's a very complicated thing. But to me, coming in, and again, I say I have moved around a good bit and been aware of various communities and how it's operating and all that, there just is such an abundance of social service organizations and nonprofits in this community to address all sorts of things that a person of limited means can find helpful that I think of this as very strong in that respect. Why do you say that it is very weak?
Well, I'd like to put on my graduate instructor hat with respect to nonprofit best practices and leadership. It's not enough for nonprofit organizations to just serve.
Yeah.
Nonprofit leadership needs to be involved in social change in our community.
Okay.
So take, for example, the issue of homelessness. We have not been successful in reducing homelessness. What that tells me is that the nonprofit sector has inadequate outcomes, so not successful. And we do not have any advocacy group that really looks at affordable housing, which is the solution. So that's an example. The other thing that we do know about our nonprofit sector, especially in the continuum of care, not all of them, but many of them, they have cash flow issues.
Mm-hmm.
They struggle just to survive. And when nonprofit organizations developmentally are in the struggle to survive, it doesn't allow their leadership to step up and do social change work. And that's really what we need. We need our nonprofit sector to band together to influence and to push our elected officials to make policy changes with respect to affordable housing. It's kind of this idea that we have recently put on our website, please don't drop off things at the homeless camps. We have so much garbage in our homeless camps because people are dropping off things. It makes them feel good, but it doesn't solve the problem. These folks need housing, and it creates an additional problem of lots of garbage in the camps. So that's one little example. And again, I think we've got some fine nonprofit leaders who are overwhelmed and have not thought about this issue beyond trying to keep their doors open. But frankly, it can't just be our agency that provides leadership you know, stirs the pot some like I do to get folks talking about this issue and thinking about this issue. Because what begins to happen is folks say, oh, there's that blonde woman, duck. And that means that my influence is waning because I'm the only one. If there were five or six of us who came to the mic and said, this situation is deplorable. We have more than 4,000 homeless people in our community. We don't have housing. We need public policy to change this. Think how powerful that would be and what a difference it would make for those folks who are in desperate need of a place to live.
Boy, I've got to have you back sometime, because there are all sorts of things that are flying through my head as I'm listening to this, and offshoots to go with, and to kind of prod and whatnot. Unfortunately, in an hour show, and actually not a full hour, because we're right getting to the very end. I've got a final segment that I do kind of myself, but so we're gonna have to wrap it up. So just to give a final word to you, a final shout out there, and what you want to say, and what else do you want to say as a final word? How do you want to wrap up the whole thing here today?
My intention is not to hurt people's feelings.
Sure.
It's not to be critical overall. My intention is to rock the boat a little bit so that people grab onto the edges and take the long view. And I think it's important to acknowledge when what we're doing as a community is not working.
Yeah.
That's the first step in making painful change.
Yeah.
And we do need to make change if we are going to impact many of our social issues that are tied together. People don't have a place to live. They're traumatized.
Yeah.
If you can just think about what it would be like when you leave today and you don't have a place to go, and you're trying to think about where you're going to eat, where you're going to take a shower, and who's going to take your things if you can't lock your door.
Yeah.
So I think that we've got to stop pretending that doing service is working here. It's not. We really need to have some strategic approaches to developing housing. And some of our nonprofit agencies have to step up and be willing to work together. And some need to go away because they can't survive over time, or they need to come together with other agencies. And the County of Chatham and the City of Savannah and the United Way need to provide some leadership in saying we need to do some things differently.
Okay. All right. Rocking the old boat. Rocking the boat, that's good in Savannah. It's not always easy, and it's not always well-received, but listen, you're right. There are some chronic issues here that just go on and on and on and on and on, and you're right. I absolutely agree with you, at least, that we've got to do something different, and that's, and do something more, and put our minds to how best to achieve the kinds of ends that we're trying to achieve here. So I'm with you in regards to that, for sure. Well, thank you so much for coming in today. Cindy Murphy Kelley, Executive Director, Chatham Savannah Authority for the Homeless. I do appreciate you coming in today, Cindy, and really and truly, I hope I can get you back. And in fact, my mind is percolating about a kind of a show that I might try and do. But at any rate, keep up the good work. We appreciate it. You're a wonderful asset here in Savannah. We appreciate the hard work you're putting into this, and the thought and care that you're putting into it. So,
thank you. I appreciate the time.
Yeah. So good deal. Thank you very much. Listeners, I will be back just in a minute. Again, it won't be long, but I do have some announcements and notations to make, as I normally do in the last segment of the show before we hit the final 9 o'clock top of the hour. So we'll be right back. Hang on. Thank you. Oh, I'm back. I'm back. See, you thought I was going to be gone so long, didn't you? No, 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 no. It's Wayne, and you are listening to Savannah Lexicon. I do appreciate it so much. I'm in the final segment here. We only got about 10 minutes. And I want to remind you that following the show, we've got a couple of great hours. Well, we got all day and all night good stuff coming at you from WRUU, LP, Savannah, Georgia, 107.5 FM. But at 9 o'clock comes Background Briefing with Ian Masters, an excellent show looking at the broader national and international political scene. Followed at 10 with Democracy Now!, Amy Goodman, a jewel if ever there was one, with, again, another hour's worth of excellent commentary and insight on the national and international political and social scene. So that's what we have coming up after Savannah Lexicon every Tuesday and Thursday. As you're listening in. Okay, I've got several things I want to throw out there to you, make you aware of. One thing is the Neighborhood Leadership Academy that is in conjunction with Savannah State University. It's a 12-week program that aims to empower future leaders, and goodness knows we need some neighborhood-level leaders for the future. And this is a partnership with Step Up Savannah, a laudable organization fighting poverty in this area. And by the way, I'm going to have the executive director of that organization myself on this very show. Let me see. When is that going to be? That is going to be actually a week from today. A week from today. So, yes, be aware of this Neighborhood Leadership Academy. You can find out more information at www.nlasavannah.org and complete an application. You can apply and make a recommendation for someone who should be in this program, you believe. I was just trying to see when it's going to start. I think it's going to be within maybe the next month. But at any rate, more information is available for that program. I think it's good. Want you to know about a couple of websites that the city has launched recently that can be good information for you. There is a new neighborhood website, so be aware of that. Particularly of interest to those who might want to be more involved in their community and bring about change in the community in some areas that need some changing and some work. The website is savannahgeorgia.gov/openneighborhoods. savannahgeorgia.gov/openneighborhoods. So take a look at it. It uses maps. It uses information that it'll give you that just helps you get a bead on the neighborhoods in the city and kind of might encourage you to become more involved. Another website is Savannah Officials, Capital Projects website. So this is a website that will show you, you know, the major projects that are going on in the city at any one time. And it highlights actually more than 300 projects across Savannah. So any project you want to know about is going to be there. And it will tell you about essentially the work that's going on, the financial data, the funding source on it, project managers, contact information, the status of various projects, the estimated time for completion, So all sorts of information at your fingertips about all these major projects that are going on in Savannah. The website to go to there is savannahga.index.aspx?nid=2281. Okay, yeah, I know that's a bit much. That's a little funky for a website page, but that is it. So it is, you know, you can probably find it by savannah.gov, Google search savannah.gov, and maybe Capital Projects website. I wouldn't be surprised if you could come in, up with it in that way. But it is at the savannahga.gov webpage. All right, so be aware of that. Want to let you know about some things that are going on in this fine city. Children's healthcare enrollment event is continuing today from 5 to 8 at the Bull Street Public Library. It's a free in-person enrollment and renewal assistance for children's health insurance programs, Medicaid, Peach Care for Kids, Pregnancy Medicaid. All right. So a helpful thing here. There are also some other ones, but for information, go to coastalcampaign.org. It'll tell you about it. There are several different elements to this and things that are going on. Another contact, Chloe Long, 661-1272. Okay, for children's healthcare enrollment events. Let's see, what else is there going on? There's always something going on. There are certainly some volunteer opportunities to be had. And by the way, we here at WRUU could use some volunteers. We're Savannah's community radio station, and we're holding an information session and volunteer orientation, 6 p.m., the 14th in Ron Hall, R-A-H-N Hall, Ron Hall at Unitarian Universalist Church, 311 East Macon Street. Okay, that is again August 14th at the Ron Hall Unitarian Universalist Church, 311 East Macon Street. More information at WRUU.org. So we can use some volunteers here at our nonprofit community radio station. Front desk reception volunteer can be used at Consumer Credit Counseling Service of Savannah. For details, contact Katie at cccssavannah.com. All right. Emergent Savannah, certainly a laudable community action organization here in Savannah. They are seeking volunteers. They advocate for the local Savannah community, providing information to create thoughtful conversation and personal action. Contact info at emergentsavannah.org, emergentsavannah.org. And so many other worthwhile places and activities you can be involved in and places you can volunteer. There's no end to it. Every show of Savannah Lexicon, unless I just really run late, is going to offer that sort of thing and that sort of information, because we do try to encourage community involvement. It's always a good thing to know what's going on, to be part of the community. Don't just leave it up to everybody else and the elected officials and all that. Number one, they need to be looked at. They need to be followed and see what they're doing, right? Okay. And plus, this is our community. It doesn't just belong to them. You know, we should be involved in the whole process. You're listening to WRUULP, Savannah, Georgia, 107.5 FM, WRUU.org. We are Savannah Sounding.